we want to help people find the videos they're interested in watching. And we start with the premise that there are hundreds of hours of video that each viewer would like to watch, and we're trying to figure out a way to connect those viewers with that 100 hours of video. My name is Christos Kidrow, and I'm responsible for search and discovery on YouTube. The easiest thing, which actually is not always that easy, is if someone were to search for a video, right? So if you search for a video, you're looking for something particular, we want to make sure that that shows up right at the top of the search results. But even that can sometimes be hard because searches are ambiguous. And even when the search itself isn't ambiguous, it's not always clear which video you're looking for. Because there's a lot of videos about just about every possible imaginable thing on YouTube. But then there's another problem, which is the fact that you may not know all the things that there are for you to watch on YouTube. And so what if it doesn't occur to you to search for something? I used to pole vault. I wouldn't imagine that there are pole vaulting videos on YouTube. But how am I ever going to find them if I don't bother to search for them? Well, somehow we've got to connect you with those videos as well.
Why do you feel compelled to connect me with a video I wasn't looking for? Is that a business thing for you because you want to keep people engaged with your product?
We know that creators uploaded these videos and there are viewers interested in these videos, and we feel like it's our job to make that connection. If we're not going to help make that connection, why should the creators bother to upload those videos? I mean, that's one thing that I'd like to make clear, is that our success depends on helping the creators find their viewers. The simplest thing is that if we see you watch one of a certain kind of video, then we know that other people who watched that video in the past went on to watch this other video. And so it's quite natural that if we see you've watched this first one, that we might think that you'd want to watch that other one too. That's mostly a matter of just accounting more than anything else. It's just keeping track of which videos get watched together. And so so that's the simplest way we do it. If you take that to a more sophisticated level, let's say you watched a few videos about Lionel Messi and you watched a few others about Cristiano Ronaldo, well, I think maybe you might be interested in soccer. So we might recommend to you a video that isn't just about Lionel Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo, but some other soccer team that's playing, because you've demonstrated some evidence in the broader subject. Another way that we might find to recommend things to you are videos that are popular in your geographical area. So, as you can imagine, Bollywood is very popular in India. It's also popular among people outside of India, but in order to recommend it to those people, we would want to see some evidence that they are interested in Bollywood.
Some of this is quite obvious, but also some of it's quite crude, you know, geographic areas. You're in India, you like Bollywood. How sophisticated are you guys getting with this now?
I think the sophistication comes from figuring out what's important about the video that indicates your interest in it. So, for instance, you might have watched some soccer videos, but it was because those were the most amazing goals. And you're not really that interested in soccer, but you're really interested in just amazing sporting things. Or you might have watched those videos because they were from a team that you happen to follow, because that's an area of the world that you're from. And so the sophistication comes in separating those two kinds of associations. Or even at a more crude level, in figuring out what's important about that video that that would make us want to suggest it to some other person.
Do you have to understand people, or are you just like just number crunchers, just trying to crunch harder and harder?
The human understanding part is where we take our intuition for what sorts of changes we might try next. You can imagine that there's a lot of things that we could try, and we can't do all of them at once, and so we have to use some intuition about which sort of things we expect might be more or less successful than other things. First of all, we look at experiments a lot. So we're running A-B tests on YouTube itself. We also do qualitative research, so we invite people to come and sit with us and watch them use YouTube and ask them the kinds of things they're interested in and ask them that they would expect to find that on YouTube, if they've ever seen that on YouTube. You know, how would they go about finding it on YouTube? And we use those sorts of qualitative analyses to try to guide our intuition for which sort of experiments we run. But It all comes back to making these broad changes and then experimenting with them. And what's important about that is because each change that we make, because we've done experiments, we can be sure that it's improved the situation. Now, it may not have improved it uniformly across the board, but overall, it's been an improvement.
What is the biggest gripe, and who does it come from?
The biggest gripe is, you have a billion videos, and I can't find anything good to watch. And that's basically, solving that problem for the viewers is our mission. Of course, people often say as well that they can't find the video that they're looking for, and you know, there's just many, many different queries and ways that people go about looking for things, and you know, we keep working on them one after another until we figure them out. Well, it's easy for our systems to get confused by, in my case, I'll give you an example. A friend sends me a video about a ski race in Southern California, and it's because my cousin has a boat entered in this ski race. I watch his video, and it's actually quite long, and then I watch a couple more videos, but I'm not really very interested in this sort of thing. The next day I come back, and there's more videos waiting for me about this ski race. I think, okay, well, that's fine, but 2 weeks later I come back, and there's yet more videos about this ski race. And I think to myself, I'm sorry that I watched those videos about the ski race. You got me, I did, but what do I have to do to get you to realize that I'm not gonna watch any more of these? Well, I mean, it's easy for our systems to become confused about the fact that you happen to have watched it at one time, but you're not really interested in it very much, as opposed to, well, you watched a little bit less of something, but that's something that you'd really like to see more of. And so we don't have, the information we have to go on is what you and other people have watched in the past. And so using all of that, and by the way, it's only you and a billion other people, using all of that and trying to make sense of it is what becomes hard.
Do you build a random chance element into it? I'm not saying like here's a completely random video, but does it allow for a degree of, this is another baseball video, but it's a bit of a wild card, or is that not? Because I guess I'm touching on making it homogenous.
We do work on trying to increase diversity. And the challenge there is that we have an intuitive belief that increasing diversity will lead to the opportunity to get even more viewership in the future. But every time we try to increase diversity, we tend to reduce the amount of viewership we have in the short term.
Why?
Well, I think it's because we haven't quite gotten it right yet. And so, you know, until we can recommend sort of unexpected things that are almost always right, people will just go away. They won't see as much of what they were looking for or what they expected, and they go away. And so, I guess it's quite a high bar to add some diverse things there. And so even though we have this intuition and our experiments tend to make us more conservative with it, that's the way that we want to go about trying to add. I wouldn't call it, I would say that the naive approach to trying to increase diversity would be to add a random element. And I can assure you that that's not going to work because, you give up too much viewership in the short term. And so what we've learned is that random isn't good enough, and we need to make it so that we're almost always right when we add some diverse and unexpected element. My holy grail is to come to YouTube and have it find the hundreds of hours of videos that I can't stop watching, because those are the ones that I'm interested in. And I think the important point about this is that it's not going to be the same as yours or someone else's. And you might think, well, how different can it be? I mean, you know, I and all my friends seem to like all the same videos that we see on YouTube. And while that may be true, think about, you know, think about some children that you know, and their, you know, their favorite videos probably will be different than yours. And then think about your parents. Their videos would probably be different than yours. And now think about the people in another country and how different what they're interested in watching is from yours. Like, we need to solve this problem for everybody across the world. And that is really the holy grail, is how do we connect each one of those people with their diverse interests with the videos they're looking for and want to watch. I think the most important thing is that we are very interested in helping the creators connect to their fans and helping them increase their viewership, because that's entirely in our interests. And so that's the thing that I want to make sure people understand, is that when we make changes to things, it's because we absolutely believe that it improves the ability for creators to be successful. And everybody was going to click on that one.
And when someone's writing code, they need to put the logic in the code that says, you know, where you should stop.